But first of all today, let's turn to the subject of buying British, because very often these days it's difficult to do just that. Even this Union Jack hat, believe it or not, was made in Hong Kong. Let's take another example. Stereo cassette recorders, for instance, one of these things. Now, if you wanted to buy one of these, you'd be fairly hard put to find a British one in the shops. In fact, last year, 1,300,000 of these were imported from Japan and from other countries into the United Kingdom.
11.5 million foreign-made sports shoes like these came into Britain last year and are being bought in our shops. And many of all the light bulbs that are sold in this country come from abroad. And a great deal of the expensive chinaware sold in this country is made in West Germany. And even members of Parliament in the House of Commons dine off German plates.
So it's not just Japanese cars like this Datsun that are taking over vast shares of our domestic markets. Imported products now account for 15% of all the goods we buy. And it's a proportion that appears to be rising.
But why is it, when Britain is in such economic difficulties and is in need of improving its balance of payments, why do we find so many foreign-made goods in our shops?
Well, as members of the EEC, we are committed to the principle of free trade between the 9 member countries of the common market. And besides that, Britain, together with 83 other countries, is also a member of something called the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade. That's GATT for short. Now, GATT is a gentleman's agreement, aiming to promote fair and free trade amongst its member countries, lowering tariffs wherever possible. But if necessary, the 83 members of GATT will agree to countries taking measures to protect certain of their own industries. And in the case of the textile and clothing industries, many countries have done just that.
You see, developing countries like India, for example, have lower costs and therefore can produce textiles and clothing at cheaper prices than developed countries like the United Kingdom. So in order to protect established textile industries in developed countries like our own, agreements have been reached placing a limit or quota on the amount of foreign-made textiles that can be imported.
All of which should make people like Gerald French of the Clothing Manufacturers Federation very happy. But he isn't, so I asked him to explain why cheesecloth shirts from India are upsetting British makers.
It's because the very large quantities of them which are coming into the market. They're coming in at prices with which the British industry can't hope to compete because of the cost of production in this country. And they're swamping in their millions, taking up a very large part of the market.
But surely, isn't there supposed to be a quota on the import of these shirts from India?
Yes, there is a quota. It's a very reasonable quota of about 700,000 for 1976. But this is a quota for shirts which are proper factory-made products. Where a shirt is not a factory-made shirt, but it's what you might call a hand product shirt, a craft product shirt, we've all agreed that they can come in outside the quota, in addition to the quota.
And how many of those cottage industry shirts have been coming in then?
Well, in the first 9 months of this year, at least 6.5 million of these shirts have come in, compared with 1975, when about 1.5 million of these shirts came in.
Does that suggest to you that those 6.5 million were all each individually handmade?
We have very grave doubts about this. Firstly, the kind of industrial organisation that would be needed to collect and market shirts in that volume, and realise that England's not the only country that they're sending these to. It's far more than one feels that a craft industry could put together.
Now, what about the Red Chinese situation? Recently, there was a very strict quota on Red Chinese imported shirts. What's happened there?
Yes, in the middle of August, the government announced that they were going to restrict imports this year from China to 450,000 shirts. As at that time, something just over that quantity had already come in. So we all confidently believed that this would mean there would be no more shirts coming from Red China during the rest of this year. And lo and behold, in September, another 350,000 shirts came in. And altogether, in the first 9 months of this year, 890,000 shirts have come in against a quota of 450,000. The problem of the developing trade in textiles is a problem for all the developed countries of the Western world. And between them, they have agreed that there must be a control in the development of this trade. It's very easy, as we have already talked about with the Indian shares, to find a way around these agreements. We feel that our government could do a lot more to police this agreement than is being done at the present time.
What effect has all this had on jobs in the British clothing industry?
Very disastrous. We're not a very large industry. Currently, we employ something like 32,000, 33,000 people. But over the last 4 years, we have lost something like 7,000 factories. Sorry, 7,000 workers, of course, not 7,000 factories.
Of course, one of the big problems from your point of view is that at £2 each, a shirt like that is a bargain. Could the British industry make a shirt like that for that price?
Well, it's very doubtful indeed that we could even buy the material to put into a shirt for £2, let alone paying wages to people who have to make these up.
I suppose another problem you have is that, to me, the customer, a shirt at £2 is a bargain. Why should I buy a more expensive British product?
A shirt at £2 is indeed a bargain, and as I've said, we're by no means suggesting that you should not be able to buy a shirt at £2. All we're suggesting is that the numbers of them which come in should be limited.
Gerald French there from the Clothing Manufacturers Federation. And with me now is John Carvel. John is industrial correspondent for the Guardian newspaper. John, can you explain to me how is it possible that countries can evade these quotas?
Well, in general, I think the quotas work fairly well and they cover about three quarters of our clothing, for instance. But foreign countries are able to find loopholes. And I think two of the examples that we've just heard about, the Indian shirts and the Chinese shirts, are two of those. The Indian shirts, for instance, it's pretty obvious that they've been manufactured by power looms and shouldn't have come in. And I think we've been caught by not fixing the quota restrictions fairly enough. Another example was with suits from Eastern Europe. We put a quota on suits, but no sooner had we done it, but they simply imported the jackets without the trousers. And that, since that came under another heading, they were able to get away with that. What happens, though, is that as soon as these loopholes are discovered, action is taken to close them. It's just as you close one, another one opens.
If an importer brings in vastly more, for instance, shirts than the quota says, in fact, takes up all of next year's quota as well, does that result in a total non-import year?
It does, yes. The Chinese shirts are a very good example that Mr. French has just mentioned. They should have imported about 450,000 this year. They've imported double that, which virtually means they'll be able to import none next year.
And that really does mean there won't be any coming in?
Well, the details have yet to be fixed, but that's what the government's planning, I understand.
Briefly, what other quotas are there?
Well, as I say, the main area of quotas is covering the textile industry, and about three quarters of textiles from the cheap, low-cost producing countries are covered. In addition to that, there's some quotas on footwear from Eastern Europe, mm-hmm. and there are some voluntary quotas, for instance, with Japan on ball bearings and colour televisions.
John, thanks very much indeed. Joan?
So, in an effort to control imports, quotas can be put on the amount of some foreign goods coming into this country. But sometimes, though not that often, foreign goods are dumped over here. Now let's have a look at some examples. Last winter, about 30,000 raincoats from Hong Kong, like this one, were dumped. And 165,000 alarm clocks made in Red China were dumped in the first 9 months of this year. But if you're wondering what dumping means, let's find out from John Carvel.
All right, John, so what is the definition of dumping?
Well, dumping is selling goods in a foreign country more cheaply than you sell them at home.
Why would any country want to dump goods?
Well, there's two reasons for that. It might want to dump goods to get rid of its surplus production, and that would apply particularly to communist Eastern Bloc countries. It might also want to dump goods to try and get a stranglehold on the domestic market by weakening the competition from companies in the country.
Hmm. How widespread is dumping and what measures are taken to stop it?
Well, I think you can tell that by the number of measures which have been taken, which are 30 anti-dumping actions, duties imposed because of dumping in the last 18 months. Of course, they're far more than that in terms of inquiries. Lots of people claim dumping, which isn't the case. But 30 cases means there's some, but not a massive amount.
Isn't it possible, though, that we could be getting all too frenetic about dumping, that people will eventually confuse good selling techniques, good bargains, with dumping?
I think this is the case, and this is the case of the people who claim dumping falsely. What we are seeing a great deal of is that foreign countries are able to make goods more cheaply, and we simply can't compete. There's no unfairness about it, it's just we're not good enough at it.
Just the way of the world. John, thanks a lot.